Yeah, we just kept talking about it. We'll just like sit down and talk like we always do. He looked at me and said, my God, you've worked with so many airports. How can you be nervous? I said, look, there's 4,000 people in here. Okay, so let's start. London. What was it like shooting 24 in London?
It was difficult. You know, they've got a lot of rules. The gun thing was a real issue. There would be moments in 24 over the 8 seasons that we did before we shot in London, where if we had an idea, we'd just go, oh my God, okay, this is a great opportunity for this or this or this. And literally, we could look at a guy named Sterling, who is a prop guy on our show, and we'd say, okay, we need an RPG, and he would just bring it out of his truck. We needed 6 weeks to even have it gone on set. We needed 6 weeks.
Locations.
Advance notice, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that became kind of difficult. Having said that, there was a fantastic kind of thing that happened out of that where we had to start thinking, okay, well, instead of just killing somebody, how else can we be dramatic about something? So, kind of like mothers, necessity of invention.
Like a window, for example?
Yeah. And so we had to start thinking of different ways to do stuff. And so in the end, it was fantastic. The crew was amazing. That was a very difficult thing. We had shot for 8 years with the same crew. I think 30-some-odd children were born. God knows how many marriages had succeeded and failed over the course of that time. But we had become very close, and so it was very odd shooting with a different group of people, and it took us a few months, actually, in all fairness, to kind of get close to each other. And I think we all stood off in our own way, but it was, London was a fantastic experience. John and I had one kind of pivotal moment where we were shooting on the Thames River, and we were looking down, and John was setting up a long shot down the Thames. And we were thinking of everything from the defeat of the Spanish Armada, you know, 700 years ago to now. Oh my gosh, sorry, 300 years ago. But it was amazing walking by a building that was 500 years old, and it kind of looked average.
Yeah.
There was a texture in the UK where we got to shoot that was unique and special, and we kept acknowledging it.
And talk about some of the times we were in central London and we attracted 200-300 people would be there watching us.
Well, that's another thing. Again, the rules are interesting. You know, in Los Angeles, police officers are basically saying you can't walk here. In London, they can't. People are very, very clear about their rights. And this sidewalk is mine. It's in the Magna Carta. And they would, we would get sometimes when we did some of the scenes early on, certainly entering in and exiting from the subway stations in Piccadilly. We would get up to 3,000 people watching. Now the thing about that that's kind of amazing is that they actually did listen. So 3,000 people, you say, okay, our camera's aiming in this direction, now do you mind moving across the street? You would watch this giant ant farm.
Or we were
to the left, and I was like, oh my God, we'd never be able to do that back home. They would never listen, they'd be like, Marilyn, who plays Chloe. don't know how to do this. And I said, internalize it. And so then she does the scene, and she's fantastic, and she starts to cry. And I said, wow, that came out of nowhere. And she said, no, I started crying because I couldn't believe 2,000 people were just sitting watching me in the car. And
see, that's why we get performance on Twitter. So it's season 8, you look up at the satellite, you say you're going off the grid, and 24 hands. And then you get a phone call. Was it your worst nightmare or dream come true when you got that phone call? Or somewhere between?
So honestly, I think, you know, this is a conversation with Howard as well. I think we left it open at season 8 because I think we had every intention of doing the film. And for a variety of reasons, that did not end up happening. This character has been the greatest gift in my career. So when I get a call from Howard, and I think I was doing a play on Broadway at the time, when I get a call saying, I've got this great idea, what do you think about doing it again? There's 5 minutes of caution. Oh my gosh, I could never do that. When we started. But it was, you know, I was happy to get the call, and I don't think it took us long, all of us, you, myself, Howard. I think we re-signed up pretty quickly.
But then once...
Oh, God, panic. Panic is extraordinary because I think, you know, and if you honestly ask any of us, over the course of the 8 seasons, we'll never say we made a perfect season. Not for a second. But there was enough that we were proud of that when we put it to bed after the 8 seasons, we were really proud of everything we did. So the idea of opening that up again and potentially damaging that was massive. And so for the 6 months between when we agreed to start shooting season 9 to shooting it, I had managed to turn myself inside out and into a complete mess. So by the time I got to London, when John first saw me, I was like, oh. I didn't even know how to talk. And I remember the first 3 days that we were shooting. Does this seem familiar? You know, is this anything like Jack Bauer? Is this, you know, I was so worried about not kind of serving the character and the story and in all fairness, the franchise. 24. Justice. I don't know about myself.
From my end, the very first shot, and it wasn't even planned, it just happened to be that way. If you remember, it was a big action day.
Yeah.
Was there. And the very first shot that happened to be Kiefer's first shot as the returning Jack Bauer. There's a shot with the camera goes pushing forward, he's got his head out, and so typical Jack Bauer pose, and he goes flying by the camera, and he looks at me, and I go, yeah, we're back. And it's just right away I knew that we're all okay. But
it was a madhouse for me. The next shot was me jumping over a railing,
right,
and falling 20 feet down to the beach, and it's one of the opening sequences. And I looked at John and said, you know, I'm a little older, I don't know if I can get over that.
It's a different Jack Bauer. It's a slightly different Jack Bauer. He's meaner, throws people out windows. He's just, of course, he just went in there and sort of drove. I think even in those last scenes when he was shooting those guys in the dock, he just kind of kept shooting them again, even after he shot them. This was a meaner Jack. I mean, how did that?
That's one of my favorite stories, and I'll get to that in a second, but the armor that we did have, and you have to understand, they count the bullets in front of you, they are so specific about, oh, you know, have you ever held a gun before? You got it.
Yes.
And they really are very specific, but this armor was fantastic, and over the time we kind of got closer, and towards the end of the show, when really started shooting people, and I would shoot people twice after they were dead. I was like, man, I love that part. I think I'm not worse than anybody. But I think one of the things things, we were so cognizant of trying to bring this, not necessarily to a close, but certainly evolve from what we've done, and we all have too. I mean, we've gotten older and everything else. And so the thing that I liked about, I went back and watched the very first season, and most importantly, the very first episode. There was so much hope in this guy. You know, he was in his kitchen with his wife.
He smiled a lot.
Yeah. And the evolution of this guy is now he's with everything that he's lost and everything else, and he's run out of patience. And so there is a much more aggressive nature to the character in the context of season 9 than anything else, because he's done. He's not fighting for his own life anymore. He's trying to carve out something that he thinks is right for himself and the planet, and maybe trying to protect his family. But there's nothing in his immediate future that he's fighting for, which is a very different tone.
Yeah, very different.
And we focused a lot on that. Yeah.
It also meant keeping the tattoos. Mm-hmm. It also meant keeping the tattoos. Something we talked about.
Well, and I've lost a lot of patients too, so I was tired of covering them, so. I wrote in a diary, and actors do this a lot, where they'll just write a backstory for whatever their character is. And mine was complete bullshit. Justifying the tattoos on my arms and why I didn't have to cover them. Patience with that.
But staying on that, talking about Jack and how much he changed, let's jump to the last episode. And sort of what happened there, and when you walked to that helicopter, and that little smile at the end, and you know, where did Jack end up? Where did Jack end up in all this?
Sorry.
Where did Jack end up in all this? Well, by the time we got to episode 12.
Well, I think the fact that he managed to save Chloe in that moment gave him some satisfaction, and that the day had been finished. And that gave him some satisfaction. And thank you for the moon. But one of the things, I mean, we went through so many different ideas for that ending. You know, even John and I were sitting there and we thought, well, maybe for the DVD, we'll just have Jack pull out a hand grenade in the helicopter and just blow it up. You know, we never had that kind of freedom before, where the end was whatever we can make it. And Howard's going to come up in a minute, and we'll talk about that. It's an unbelievably difficult thing trying to figure out how to do that. And I think on some level, and I was as much a part of it as anybody, I think on some level we kind of topped out because it's hard to let it go. It's hard to end it, you know. And so I think we kind of became ourselves as people who were making the show. We came kind of full face to that. Now it was difficult, and we were talking about it last night. We all had dinner last night. There's a wonderful rush that we get. I mean, when I get to sit in a room like this with you all, which trust me, never happens. There's something amazing. This really did matter to us, and we don't work in a vacuum, and we are cognizant and aware of your response and everything else. It's the most energizing thing you can imagine. In fact, it's a high, and I think kind of trying to create the end of our show this season, because we had said this was the last season and this is what we want to do, it was really difficult for us, because I think all of us individually didn't want to really let it go. And we fought against it, and we fought for it. And so, and your response to the end for this season was really gracious and kind.
Thank you. Thank you. mean, it's great, I think, from their point of view, because you get these characters that they know. But from our point of view, they're our friends. It's fun to have them back in our lives.
Well, Kim Raver specifically, I mean, this is one of my dearest friends. And Mary Lynn, we work together all the time. She's kind of got this odd thing going on around her, like there's a halo around her where you go, you can't kill her. We'd rather you die first. She doesn't kind of come to the set with the same look of fear. But Kim Raver is amazing. Kim Raver is someone who I met on this show. And the very first scene we did was a behind the scenes thing that was actually on a DVD where I push her up against the wall, I undo her blouse, I put my hand around her back, and I kiss her.
And this was a wall involved too.
And what?
It was a wall.
Yes, and I push her up against the wall. And literally I met her 5 minutes before we did this. And then met her husband. So it's a unique experience. And Kim is so unbelievably professional and such a great actor. And we laughed about this. And literally, I hadn't seen her for 2 years. And she walks on the set, and it picked up exactly like that. The only time where it gets kind of funny is when everybody goes out to dinner, and it's like, oh my God, how are the kids doing and everything else. But when the actors come on our set, and this is a real tribute to John, they're there to work, and everything just seems loose. It's like that great friend that you had that you haven't seen in 15 years, and then you kind of reconnect, and all of a sudden, it was like you were there in 10 minutes, 15 years ago. It's like that.
And Bill, we're here with Bill DeRoy.
He's crazy.
He really is.
Bill just wants to be playing polo. He's a great horseman, he's a great polo player. And he was the one guy in England who's like, I can't understand why they don't feed you better. The rest of us were, oh my God, did you see that building? I mean, did you go to Chicago Square? Did you, there were so many things to do. And he was like, I can't sleep. Fantastic miserable travel.
At the TV, like, there's only 15 channels. Can't watch anything.
That's right.
The funniest thing. So, but he did, he was just incredible this year. The other thing, I've got to just give you a little heads up. When you get the Blu-ray, which all of you are going to get, when you re-watch this show, watch his wardrobe. Watch when his tie is undone. Watch, you know, when he's got his jacket off, his shirt sleeves up. That is all Bill. And he had a very specific reason why he was doing all of it. When the shirt sleeves are up, when he's talking to the thing, he puts the jacket back on. But watch it. If you track it, it's actually really fun to watch his wardrobe, the shirt, the tie, all of that was him. He was really, really conscious about that. That's what actors do. They bring that to him. So, in speaking of that, talk about your process, Keeper. So you get the script. Do you look at it? Do you start sort of memorizing it a week before or the night before? Like, what's the process once you've got sort of the words on the page?
Okay, so he's cheating here. He's asking this question.